We do have a new show coming. You said something in December. We have a new show coming. It will be released as a podcast and on YouTube per normal. Club and Country is back under the Extra Time banner and Continental Tire banner. We're recording that first episode after the two-game international window for the U.S. national team. So it'll probably come out, you know, week of the 29th sometime. Basically summing up what happened in those games. Got some good interviews for you. Looking around Major League Soccer, setting the states from an international perspective for the year. We're happy to do that every single month. Ecstatic even. It gives us a lot more time to dig in. Let's talk about that U.S. national team roster now, though. March 25th against Jamaica, March 28th against Northern Ireland, both those games in Europe. There are 26 players called in. You've got Brooks, Cannon, Richards, Adams, Reyna, Sargent, and Weah all leaving after that first game for quarantine reasons. That still leaves a good roster back behind for that Northern Ireland game. But I want your reaction here, Doyle, as people maybe go refresh themselves with the exact names on the roster at MLSsoccer.com. What are you thinking as you see Greg Berhalter's most recent group?
The first thing that jumped out at me was like, this is going to be our first chance to see Christian Pulisic in a year and a half, almost. The last time we saw Christian Pulisic was that 2-0 loss to Canada in the Nations League way back in October of 2019. And we're not just going to see him. We're going to see him with something pretty close to what we all think is the first choice 11, other than Weston McKennie, who was given this camp off because he's been nursing a hip injury. So I'm pretty stoked about that. Pulisic has had a struggle of a year with Chelsea. He does seem to be settling into a super sub role, which I am completely fine with. Like, if you're an attacking sub, an attacking super sub for a top three team in the Premier League, a top eight team in the world, that is fine. You do not need to be playing every single week, but we do need to see him start getting more reps with this first team, especially because the way the U.S. plays, especially defensively, has changed in the past year and a half. They press more. The wingers come inside and become more playmakers rather than out wide and trying to beat guys off the dribble. And so it's different, and that is the big takeaway for me. Obviously, I'm excited to see Chris Richards as well. We did see him last camp, but now he's a regular starter in the Bundesliga, which is a huge box to check. Brennan Aaronson's another interesting one because there aren't a lot of wingers here. And I've always thought that Brennan Aaronson was better out wide, or out wide's not necessarily – Brennan Aaronson has always been better when his responsibilities are more linear, when he can just push the opposing line back, you know, go between the lines rather than have to, like, interpret space and control the tempo. That's when Brennan Aaronson's at his best, and that's kind of the role he's playing now for Jesse Marsh out wide. In a 4-4-2 or a 4-2-2-2. And I think that's very similar to the winger role for Greg Berhalter's national team. So I think we're going to get to see that as well. And the other takeaway is, like, just with the way the team's constructed, we might see kind of a 3-6-1 in the second game, something where there's no true defensive midfielder, something where it's two guys sort of like sharing the job. And we've tried it before under Berhalter and it stunk, but that doesn't mean it's not worth trying again, specifically because you need more than one club in your bag if you're going to get through World Cup qualifying. And, like, what happens if Tyler Adams isn't available? Jackson Ewell can do that on his own against some teams, but, like, what if we don't have Tyler Adams from Mexico? You're not going to play Jackson Ewell as a lone D-mid versus Mexico. So we're going to see, I think, some wrinkles in that second game. I'm excited about all of that, even though I am sort of bracing myself for the fact that it's not going to be pretty.
Can I ask you this, Dave? What do you think Greg Berhalter wants to get out of these games? Because I put out my, I would like to see this 11 on Twitter via the Extra Time account, and we can slag that
weird,
later if we want.
Because ETR's boy, Daryl DK, was not in that 11.
He wasn't, but I want to get – give him the start in the second game, man.
Yeah,
some guys
fair.
Are going
Sergeant
home. Some
will
guys
leave.
Are going home. We give Sargent his chance. He's been scoring goals. What should Greg want to get out of this particular camp? Because this is it before Nations League.
Yeah, so I think for him, it's building culture is one, right? And we've heard so much already, a lot of it with Yunus Musa, of – the group getting together for the first time in forever. And for some guys, the first time they've ever met with the Wales Panama game, and then how much it's meant and how much they've stayed in touch and all those things going forward. And then I think to Doyle's point, we saw them finally put everything together versus Wales, where we'd been so excited, but none of them had gotten on the field together. And there was good moments, but it wasn't the exact performance we wanted. And Panama was a bit of a different game. So I think you're looking for a more cohesive performance in this first game from this group, where a lot of players will know their roles better. They'll have talked over the last few months about what they need to do, how the system works, what they can bring to that system. And so can you do it on the front foot against Ireland and finish and create some opportunities? And so I think it's just that slow progression, that next step. But you have so many pieces in here that are going to be starting in that Nations League or the Gold Cup, whichever one is considered more important. It seems like the Nations League
because of timing.
And right? I think also
you could get the whole team in for Nations League and you have them there for a couple of weeks. It's after the European season and it doesn't cut into their preseason.
Right.
And honestly, it doesn't cut into their downtime. So these guys will need rest.
And we talked about this when we had Greg Berhalter on. The focus is World Cup qualifying.
Yeah.
So getting ready for a month-long tournament is not the focus. The three-game window that they're going to make with a friendly around the Nations League, that is more what they're preparing for. So it seems like that will be what they're doing. So that's the next step, right? Because this is the last time he's going to see all those players until then. And I think it's exciting. I think it's exciting when this roster comes out that it's like, yup, he's here, he's here, he's here, where we haven't had that in a while of this is the first team, this is the first group. And one of the other ones that's interesting is now that Musa's in, you don't have to, and I don't want to say that they did anything wrong, you're not appealing to him anymore. So now we're going to start to see how will he be used, because maybe there was the idea in the last game, let's put him in central midfield, let's make him get a lot of touches, let's make him enjoy it. And now it's, what does he do for this team going forward? And he's going to be huge for this national team because of, I think, one, his versatility and his ability to affect the game in a lot of ways from a lot of different places, especially with the pieces the U.S. has, because Doyle talked about all these, you know, different players. There's a lot of versatility. And so there's a lot of guys who can do a few different things. Then you've got a couple specialists. So it'll be interesting to see who everything is built around over the next 6 months.
It feels to me like Musa works really well as one of those 2-8s.
Yeah,
and I
don't think he's a winger at all.
Yeah, I think that's where he's at. And I think if Weston's here, you would see the Musa Adams Weston midfield. And we haven't seen, we just haven't seen these guys together all that much. Jamie Hill tweeted this out. He does a great job with this stuff. Pulisic, McKinney, and Adams. His number is that they have 76 minutes together all time. I mean, that's what Greg Berhalter, I think, in this camp and in the Nations League is trying to address ahead of World Cup qualifying. Here's the 11 I would throw out against Jamaica, and I don't have Gio Reyna in it. So if you guys don't agree with that, feel free to get at me after this. I have Stefan in goal. I have Dest at right back because I still think that Dest's primary position and his abilities, you need to find a solution to let him be there. So I'd have him at right back. I'd have Richards. I'd have Brooks in the middle. And I'd have Robinson at left back. Give him reps. See if he's making jumps forward. See if it can work. I know defensive cover might be an issue, but that's why you have Tyler Adams at defensive midfield and Musa and Legette for me in front of him. I know people get mad about this. My God, my mentions, the Gio Reyna hive is very, very, very strong. They accuse me of hating Gio Reyna. I accuse them of not seeing the world for what it is, which is a world where Sebastian Legette can do a hell of a job for Greg Berhalter, has proven it and might be a better option. In fact, I think a better option in must-win games right now than Gio Reyna is. Tim Way on the right wing, Sargent up top, Pulisic on the left. A lot of that is, hey, these guys are going to be leaving, so they got to start. I personally just don't think that Gio Reyna has to start. I think he's an incredible weapon off the bench. And I just think Sebastian Legette has proven to Greg Berhalter that he can do all the things that he needs to do and is, at times, a game changer in that position.
But so, we have talked about for months that there is a difference between playing El Salvador at home and Mexico on the road. And the U.S. needs to have different pieces for all of that. And I would say Gio Reyna hasn't been starting for Dortmund, and so I wouldn't say that he has to start in this game. But going forward, your best attacking team has Gio Reyna in it, and there will be times when that is the group that you do need to use or should use for some matchups.
Can I ask this, though? I know that you don't, Doyle. Can I ask this? I don't actually think Gio Reyna for Legette would be the move. I think it would be Gio Reyna for Weah.
Yeah, I'm fine with that. I don't disagree with that. But also, when you have all your best players, that's a different conversation than that. And that's why I say, does Yunus Musa work there? Because it just gets you more of the pieces you want on the field in more comfortable positions going forward. In a game like that, if you can start Reyna in the middle with Weston and Tyler because you know you're going to dominate the ball. Does Musa start out wide or does Brendan Aaronson start out wide? Now, they don't have to stay there. It's not most of what they're going to do, but that's how you're getting everyone on the field.
I understand what you're saying, Gasman, but I kind of disagree with some of your rationale. But in the end, it's all moo. I think the guys who have to leave after the first game are going to start the first game. And that probably means Cannon at right back and Dest at left back instead of Anthony Robinson at left back and Cannon at right back. It certainly means Brooks and Richards. And it means Gio Reyna is going to start somewhere. He hasn't, like you said, he hasn't been starting for Dortmund. He hasn't been productive for Dortmund. He had two or three goals and four assists in his first six games. And he's had like two goals and one assist in his subsequent 27. They've been playing him a little bit in central midfield, a little bit on the wing. He hasn't been productive in either spot. That's fine. He's 18. He's a talent. I'm with Weeby. If we had a must-win game tomorrow, he probably doesn't start. But this is not a must-win game. This is a friendly, and this is a chance to get reps with the first team, and he's clearly on the track of being a first teamer. So let's see, like, whether it's at wing in place of Weah or whether it's in central midfield where we didn't see him last time as one of those free eights in place of Legette. We're going to see him from the whistle at one of those two spots.
And I'm fine with that. And you're probably right. I tweeted that. I said, look, I'm probably wrong about this, but in my mind, Weah again,
is also leaving.
Okay. Then my guess is that
it'll be at the eight.
We'll see. Yeah. And let's see him there. I think he's played more often there for Dortmund. He's
been
played
better
on the
out of the middle, I would say.
So yeah,
he hasn't been great at either, but out of the middle, he can kind of have more runners off him to make decisions and slip passes where
that's the problem, isn't it?
Yeah. But he knows where those spaces are. It's just releasing the ball at the right time.
Yeah.
But I'd rather put him there than out wide where saw in the Wales and whatever game, he's not comfortable running at guys with a ton of space. That's not where he's at his best. So I wouldn't try and find those opportunities for him.
And this is probably all moot when Weston McKennie's there anyway, because Weston McKennie will just play there and Sebastian Legette won't. But my thing is, it's all about World Cup qualifying and it's about the Nations League.
I think Danny Leyva might start out in there, actually, and push Weston.
We'll get to that later.